Good morning. I was born in the small town of Reddish, England. As a young man, the death of my dear mother proved to cause a great spiritual awakening in my life. And although I grew fearful of sin and began to read the scripture and be frequent in prayer, I had no rest in the soul. In this sad and doubtful state, I, Obadiah Holmes, continued many years. In 1638, my wife and I resolved to venture the danger of the sea to come to New England. Soon after landing at Boston, we made our way up and settled at Salem. After 5 years at Salem, we relocated to the town of Rehoboth, becoming members of the church led by the Reverend Samuel Newman. However, Mr. Newman and I soon grew in sharp contention regarding matters of doctrine and church discipline. It was during this time that God at last brought me to consider his own love to the poor lost man. God looked at me as a rebel, an enemy, yea, dead in sin and trespasses. He then said, "Live through the blood of Christ, be cleansed, and in him be loved." I was baptized along with 8 others. After our baptism, we held our own services on the Lord's Day and came to be known as the Schismatics. In June of 1650, a petition against us came before Plymouth's court. The court ordered us to cease our meetings, but we refused and were ordered back to Plymouth's court, presented by the grand jury for continuing of meeting upon the Lord's Day, contrary to the order of this court. Those members of the court indicting us included renowned men such as Governor William Bradford, Captain Miles Standish, and John Alden. Because of this, I and the others were forced to leave Rehoboth and to settle in Rhode Island. There we joined the First Baptist Church at Newport under the leadership of the Reverend John Clark. In July of 1651, Mr. Clark, myself, and Mr. John Crandall journeyed to Lynn, Massachusetts to encourage an older brother in Christ and fellow Baptist, Mr. William Witter. We arrived at Mr. Witter's house and the next day held a service. As Mr. Clark was preaching the word of God, the service was abruptly interrupted by the presence of 2 constables. We were placed under arrest, and the next morning were sent to Boston to be tried for our crimes, the greatest of which being seducing and drawing aside others after our erroneous judgment and practices. After a week in prison, the day of our trial came. We were examined in the morning and sentenced in the evening, without producing either accuser, witness, jury, or law of God or man. Mr. Crandall was fined £5, Mr. Clark £20, but I, being excommunicated, was fined £30. Each man was to pay his fine or be well whipped publicly. As I went from the bar, I expressed myself in these words: "I bless God, I am counted worthy to suffer for the name of Jesus." Whereupon, John Wilson, pastor as they called him, struck me, saying, "The curse of God go with thee." On September 5th, 1651, the day of my punishment had arrived. The executioner tied me to the post and reared back his whip. And as the man began to lay the strokes upon my back, I said to the people, "Though my flesh should fail, and my spirit should fail, yet my God would not fail. For in truth, as the strokes fell upon me, I had such a spiritual manifestation of God's presence as the like thereof I have never had, nor felt, nor can with fleshly tongue express. And the outward pain was so removed from me that indeed I am not able to declare it to you. It was so easy to me that I could well bear it, yea, and in a manner felt it not, although it was grievous, the man striking with all his strength with a 3-corded whip, giving me therewith 30 strokes. When he had loosed me from the post, having joyfulness in my heart and cheerfulness in my countenance, I told the magistrates, 'You have struck me as with roses,' and said moreover, 'Although the Lord hath made it easy to me, yet I pray God it may not be laid to your charge.' After my recovery, I succeeded Dr. Clark as the minister of the First Baptist Church in Newport, a position I held until the day of my death. I am aware that many of you are unfamiliar with the account of my life. However, I am certain that you are all well familiar with the legacy I left behind. Of my descendants, there was one who believed that man was free to worship God as he saw fit and gave his life to preserve man's right to do so. Perhaps you know of him, the 16th President of the United States, Mr. Abraham Lincoln. He, just as I, labored diligently for the freedom you have enjoyed for generations. Will you not stand as I and those who came after me? Will you not endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ? For when even the weakest of God's own stand for truth in the midst of persecution, when the whips of the wicked strike his back, it shall be as with roses.